Good evening. Steve Helfer here. The show is The Smoking Section, working to renormalize smoking in the public's mind and throughout the land and throughout the world, working very, very hard against the World Health Organization, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the Office of the Surgeon General ad nauseum. And tonight we were going to have a guest on our show, Joe McCabe from the Phoenix Landing, but unfortunately he was unable to make it because I guess in the restaurant business you are always on call if somebody doesn't come in. But the last time Joe was on the show was about 10 years ago, and it was very interesting because at that time he wasn't smoking and he was very, very anti-tobacco. And we had a good show, a good discussion, but now he is back to smoking, I'm glad to see. And he looks very well. I guess he's a man who is in his 50s. My guess is his health is as good or better than many are all of his non-smoking friends. Which means that it would appear, at least for him and for so many smokers, tobacco does not seem to be lethal as public health zealots would have you believe. And recently I had the misfortune of going down to a memorial service for a friend of mine who my age and who was a non-smoker. At least he used to smoke when he was in high school, but at some point I think he stopped. And unfortunately, I think he probably had too much to drink one night and took a fall. And unfortunately, again, very sadly, ended up going into a coma and dying. And of course, one will not know, but I just wondered if he had been smoking, would that influence of nicotine made him just a little bit sharper, improved his brain just a little bit, perhaps made him drink a little bit less, and that he would not have died as a result of being intoxicated? Because, of course, nicotine, which is part of the reason people smoke, not all of the reason, but just part of it, has many, many beneficial effects. In fact, I'm going to go to a screen and just take a look at that. This is from the New York Times, from Jane Brody, the health editor. And according to her, and she's pretty good at marshaling all of the research, usually she does it against tobacco. She's a very anti-smoking zealot. But in one of her columns in the science section of the Times, she notes that the effects of nicotine are arousal, which means if you're a little bit sleepy or you're driving a car and you might maybe have had a little bit too much to drink, if you have a cigarette, it will arouse you. It will make you perhaps able to avoid an accident. Relaxation, well, of course, everybody knows that smoking relaxes you. I mean, that's one of the primary reasons people smoke. And we are really living in an age now of anything but relaxation. People are suffering from a lot of anxiety, and they're taking more and more pharmaceuticals, and they're behaving in very, very unrelaxed fashion. Like at one time, every single cab driver in the city of New York would have a cigar in his mouth, and he could deal thereby better with the kind of traffic problems that you experience, the kind of stress. But now, of course, since so few people smoke, only about 20% of the adult population, when we see people drive, they're just beeping their horns. If the car in front of them doesn't move just a tiny bit with the light, there goes that horn. And of course, we're having a lot of road rage. So let's see, improved mood. Well, you know, if you go to any bar or restaurant, people who are smoking are generally going to be mildly in a better mood, or if they're in a bad mood, it will probably pick up their spirits a bit. Reduced anxiety and stress, well, I went over that before. Better concentration. Well, we do know that, for example, anybody learning a skill, if he smokes, he will be able to better master that. Now, for example, I think of Eric Clapton and Keith Richards when they were really concentrating and working on their guitar work, I think, and learning the instrument. I think smoking really, really helped them to master that instrument. Of course, it wasn't necessary, but it was able to make them relax and concentrate. And then, of course, faster reaction time. And that is one of the reasons that baseball players like to chew tobacco, is because it makes them relax. And if they have to wait a very, very long time before they have any activity, if they have that tobacco, that wad of chewing tobacco in their mouth, then they can react much faster than, for example, a ball player who is just chewing on bubble gum or something of the like. So those are some of the benefits of tobacco, of nicotine, which is in tobacco. And of course, smoking is a great pleasure, especially when it's combined with something like a cup of coffee or a glass of beer or a gin and tonic, anything like that. Now, I was going to have Joe McCabe on tonight, and I wanted to talk to him about some of the things that are being aimed at smokers these days, aimed at attempts to ostracize and alienate smokers from public life. Now, Martin Luther King, who was a smoker and in fact was smoking when he was murdered in Memphis, I wonder what he would have thought of the efforts on the part of public health officials and anti-smoking groups to stigmatize that 20% of the American population, of the American adult population who smoke, which number about 42 million, which is still a lot, particularly when you consider that for the last 30 years there's been a program of harassment against these people. And one of the things is that, unfortunately, Barack Obama, who was a smoker and maybe still smokes occasionally, has been completely taken over by the anti-smoking movement. So one of the things that he has initiated is that they want to ban smoking on all campuses everywhere in the country. And not only smoking, but even the possession of tobacco. So this would make it very, very difficult for a smoker to be a faculty member, be a student, or be a staff member. I mean, I worked at Harvard for 22 years, and if I couldn't go out and step outside a building and have a smoke, it would have been a complete handicap for me to perform my job. And thereby, I wonder if Barack Obama's White House is trying to get smokers out of higher education altogether, or working in that direction, which has a remarkable similarity to what the Nazis did in Germany. When they took over, they started excluding all kinds of people from higher education. This is one of their first moves, and this was a way of getting people out of the situations where they could influence public policy. Of course, Harvard and other places have a great deal of influence over public policy in this country, as they do in the world. So if you ban smoking on college campuses, this will handicap smokers tremendously. And this is coming directly from the White House. Some people think that, this is some kind of grassroots campaign. These are always disguised as grassroots campaigns. But of course, when the federal government tells colleges something like ban smoking, they really worry because they hold the purse strings, which I think is actually a very unhealthy relationship that we have universities and colleges so dependent on the federal government for research monies and for underwriting of tuition that we don't have independent universities where people might be willing to oppose the federal government. Instead, there is this very unhealthy connection. And Dwight D. Eisenhower, when he left the office of the presidency, he gave a very, very famous speech where he was critical of the industrial military complex, but he was also very critical of a kind of elite group of people who were primarily in the universities and academia who would have a very much overly powerful influence on public policy, particularly when these people are so tied into federal grants and the like. So universities, again, it would be better if they were independent and could not be under the thumb of the federal government, in this case by banning smoking, because they know that if the federal government wants to give them a hard time, it can decide, for example, to investigate how they're reporting alleged sexual assaults are withhold some research money, are not underwrite tuition as much as they have. Well, we seem to have a phone call. You're on the smoking section.
Yeah, hi. This is the smoking section, right?
This is it. You're on, my friend.
Your nipples look very...
And so there we go. Another goofball. He's got about 300 channels to watch on YouTube and the like, but he is so bored and vacuous in his mind that he has to call and bother me, but not really a bother. Well, we're getting close to the smoker of the week. So I think I'm going to bring him up a little bit early in the program. And let's just see if I have my ducks in order here. There we go. And of course, not too many people, unless you're a real classical music fan, would know who this person is. But his name is Janos Starker. And he died in 2013. And according to the New York Times, was one of the 20th century's most renowned cellists. Now, I don't know how good this photograph is, but you do see a cigarette hanging from his mouth. And his elegance on stage, again, according to the Times, was matched by the cyclone of scotch, cigarettes, and opinion that animated his life. And again, here we have a man smoking, and he was cut. His life was ended very shortly at the age of 88. You know, I wonder how many non-smokers, certainly the average lifespan for a non-smoker male in this country, I believe, is about 80. And Joseph Starker, or Janos Starker, died at 88. For much of his life, he smoked 60 cigarettes a day. That's 3 packs a day. Though in old age, he reduced the number to 25. So again, this is Janos Starker, one of the 20th century's most renowned cellists. And it's kind of coincidental that when I spoke about smoking helping you concentrate, and let's say learn a musical instrument or write something that I mentioned, Keith Richards and Eric Clapton, both heavy smokers, at least Keith Richards still is, but when Eric Clapton was learning his instrument, he was certainly a very heavy smoker. Now, there was a very interesting incident in at one point where Janos Stoker was supposed to perform in South Carolina. And he went there, and the concert hall had banned smoking, and he was even told that he could not have a cigarette in his private dressing room. You know, so now this man, who again lived to be 88, smoked 3 packs a day, was, according to the New York Times, one of the most renowned cellists of the 20th century. He said to the orchestra, "I have lived through fascism and I have lived through communism, but I cannot abide the petty tyranny into which this country is falling, and neither should you." End of quote. Let's see. So, you know, it shows what's happening in this country, the kind of petty tyranny that is mostly manifest in the attack on people who smoke and on the habit of smoking, which of course has been in the New World, according to historians, for 8,000 years. And we will see what will happen. I mean, right now, it seems like the anti-smokers are in ascendancy, but things have ways of changing. As I have mentioned before, like probably I have mentioned everything that I'm saying now before at some point on this program, Nazi Germany had the strongest anti-smoking campaign of any modern nation. But by the end of the war, Adolf Hitler had committed suicide. The Minister of Health was soon to be hanged at Nuremberg for all his, not for his anti-smoking, but for his euthanasia experiments on people, etc. And cigarettes became the official, well, the unofficial currency of Germany. You're on the smoking section.
Hello?
Oh, sorry, cut you off. Try again if you're interested. Having a little problem with technical problems here at CCTV. My finger is a little bit too quick to squelch crank calls, which I'm not in the mood for, but I can deal with. Now, another thing that is coming down from the federal government, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, is they are trying to pressure landlords and condominium associations to ban smoking in all multifamily housing, that is apartment buildings, condominiums, public housing, etc. So they're really, really turning the screws on us smokers. Let's see. You're on the smoking section.
Yeah, hello. I just wanted to know what you thought about the, what's it called, the campaign usually run on MTV. It's about, it's like the End It campaign.
Right.
Because I smoke and I always see these, and I just wanted to know what you felt, how you felt about them.
Well, it's...
Fuck yeah!
It's probably funded by, again, the federal government, and although it's supposed to appear like some kind of grassroots campaign, it probably comes from what's called the Legacy Foundation, which was set up with state dollars. I mean, and I would be very, they used to run a campaign called the Truth Campaign on television. And I would be very, very skeptical of any campaign that calls itself the Truth Campaign. George Orwell in 1984, which was particularly prescient in this instance, you know, something that calls itself the Truth Campaign, I would be very skeptical of. For example, when you see how the tobacco companies have been vilified for the last probably about 40 years, maybe even 50 years, you know, vilified to the point where they are considered the great evil, I would be very skeptical. I would wonder, perhaps, why are they being so vilified? Maybe if people have the need to vilify to the extent that has been done with tobacco companies by the medical profession and public health professionals, I would say, well, why do you need to vilify so much? Is it perhaps that you're trying to hide something yourself, that you have a secret agenda? You know, people accuse the tobacco companies of being very interested in a profit, but all companies are interested in profit. In fact, anybody who works for a living likes to make more money than he spends. Everybody's interested in the profit. That's a very obvious agenda or motivation. But if you look at the public health profession and these anti-smokers, do they not have a secret agenda? Is their agenda not have a lot to do with this kind of petty tyranny that Janos Starker talked about, having to do with control and power? I don't think they are just concerned with the welfare of the population. I think they have their own agenda. So I would be very leery of any program that calls itself the Truth Campaign, particularly when it's funded by the government, or particularly when it's funded by people who say they want only the best for you. Because as J.P. Morgan once said, every man has two reasons to do something, the good reason and the real reason. So again, the federal government is pressuring all multifamily housing to ban smoking in residents' apartments and evict them. Now, not only is the federal government doing this, but in Boston, at least up until recently, any private landlord who prohibited his residents from smoking, again with the threat of eviction, was rewarded, a cash reward, it was called a grant, by the public health department of the city of Boston. So we're seeing actually the government bribing people to forbid residents from smoking in their own apartments. And you know, this is something that I wonder what Martin Luther King would think about. I mean, Martin Luther King was a man who talked of tolerance, and here we have this government, for it seems that no matter what, the only thing they want to do is to ostracize and alienate us smokers. And I wonder why that is. Is it possible that it's because we're not complying and that we're viewed as a danger in the sense that we don't do what we're told to do by medical authorities? It's a possibility. I don't know. Now, another thing is that under Obamacare, if you go in as an obese heroin addict with hepatitis C, you cannot be charged more for your insurance. But Obamacare encourages insurance companies to charge smokers 50% more for their premiums than other people. So you could be a very bad alcoholic or a heroin abuser, any of these things, and that's fine. That's okay. No problem. We will give you your medical insurance at a very low rate. But if you go in as a person who has no medical issues whatsoever, your heart checks out fine, your lungs check out fine, you're the proper weight, you have no particular disease, you are fit, yet you use tobacco, Obamacare encourages insurance companies to charge you a premium that's 50% higher. Now, I wonder, you know, people talk about the public or the American public or any public, and, you know, Politicians are always pandering to the public and talking about how wonderful the public is. But I wonder why so many people do nothing about these egregious unfairnesses that are taking place in our society. You know, let the smokers pay these high taxes, we can pay less. You know, let the smokers pay more for Obamacare, it doesn't bother me. Ban smoking everywhere, you know, it doesn't bother me because I don't smoke. I mean, that does not speak well for the public, that they stand back and allow these things to take place. But Cambridge Citizens for Smokers' Rights is not standing back and is not allowing these things to take place. So I hope you'll join us. You can Google us, Cambridge Citizens for Smokers' Rights. We have a great Facebook page. Hope to see you